Again, there's only two specific places the rapture is even taught in the New Testament. Here, and we already saw how the focus, the real theme, is comforting those people who are mourning the loss of dead believing Christians. Not the rapture. It's kind of thrown in as a side thing. It's taught, no doubt about it. The second place is 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And just like here in 1 Corinthians 15, if you go and look at it, you will find that Paul's main argument, the main thing he's writing about in that chapter, is about the resurrection and the difference between the natural body and the spiritual body. And the fact that the resurrection will be of a new spiritual body, and then he kind of throws in the teaching on the rapture. Those of us who are alive and remain when the Lord comes back, our natural body is going to be changed to that spiritual body. Well, there's the rapture. It's being taught. But you see, it's not his emphasis, it's not his priority. And then that's it. Those are the two areas. But an overemphasis on the rapture leads to a lot of what we call eisegesis. What does that mean? Well, exegesis, which is a word you should know. Exegesis, ex, out of. It means to take out of the text what God has said as we interpret it. To look at the writers in their original language, exegesis should involve the Greek, the Hebrew, and to see what were they writing about to their original audience, and then bring out the application. That's proper Bible study. That's what we should all strive for. Eisegesis, as you might guess, ice into, is where you take your preconceived theology and you start wedging it in verses of the scripture. So, man, you find all sorts of symbolism of the rapture. Hey, there's the rapture right there. Look at that. And look at that little verse there. You know, it's the rapture right there. And you see it over and over again. I hear it all the time. I don't know if that's symbolic of the rapture or not. I know God's word doesn't say it is. I'll give you one example. We'll get to this when we get into 2 Thessalonians, where we are told specifically that before the Antichrist can show up, there will be an apostasy, a falling away. And it'll be great, the falling away. And you know, I've heard people who are really strong on the rapture say, well, you know, that word falling away, that can simply mean departure in some uses in Greek. And so a departure. He's talking about the rapture, the departure of the church. Before the Antichrist shows up, the rapture happens. Are you kidding me? That's eisegesis. That is fitting something into the scripture that does not belong there. And there are scholars who have done that. There's no justification for it. Now, when I look at the world around us, and I know what biblical prophecy says, I do believe sincerely that the return of the Lord is near. I do believe that. I just look at the book of Revelation and how much technology would be needed for the book of Revelation to play out, and I realize, well, we've got all that technology. The idea that two dead guys can lie in the streets of Jerusalem and the whole world could view their dead bodies, how could that ever happen before satellite television? The idea that John could see this large number of Jews being taken from Israel over off to a desert place where they'd be safe, and they are on these great wings like an eagle. Well, that sounds like a guy in the first century who's never seen an airplane trying to describe what he's seeing in this vision. Not to mention the whole mark of the beast economic system. Just this week, maybe some of you saw it. Over there on, you know, MSN's homepage, there's a discussion about putting a chip in your right hand and buying and selling with that thing and doing all sorts of other good things. They said, oh yeah, the religious fundamentalists think it's crazy in the mark of the beast, but let's talk about it a little bit. It's all coming together. And of course, when I look at Israel, they're in the land like the Bible promised. They're surrounded by enemies who hate them. We see the role of Iran, that's biblical Persia, and the fact that we know that Persia is going to attack Israel with an alliance of other nations, and those nations also, when we look at the map today and use them by their common names, we recognize, boy, they're all Islamic, how interesting. And that's heavy on the front pages right now. How about the regathering of the Jews into their homeland? Fulfillment of prophecy. Do you know Jews all over the world? They will even say, I don't know why, but I just feel this drawing, this urging to move to Israel. I don't understand it. Well, I understand it. It's God. God's moving upon them. Jews in Ethiopia. Countless number of Jews in Russia and other parts of Europe. You remember not too long ago, I made the statement that in a few short decades, unless there's a dramatic change, that Europe, Western Europe, will be Islamic. And that's simply not because of war, necessarily, but because simply of population. Because the native Europeans, through abortion, homosexuality, and those who don't believe in abortion or homosexuality are just trying to raise a family, but they're just so taxed to death, they say, we can't have more than one, maybe two kids max, are being overrun in the population by the Muslim immigrants moving to those countries that are having 7, 8, 9, 10 kids. They don't care how they live, many of them. I don't want to stereotype, but that's reality, folks. So Europe's going to be Islamic in a few decades without any war, without even having to fire a gun. Say, well, is the same thing going to happen to Israel? Because there's a lot of Muslims in Israel, and I would assume the same thing applies there. Well, you know what? It would, except for this fulfillment of prophecy, because the immigration of Jews from all over the world are keeping that from happening. It's fascinating. Now, the Bible says all nations will be gathered against Israel. All nations. Does that include the United States of America? All nations? It does, doesn't it? And we're close right now. We are close. And the Jewish people sadly know it. You maybe have seen some of the polls that I've seen where the Jewish people have no confidence in the United States as an ally who will stand with them without condition if they're attacked and in these difficult times. And just in the last month, I've been to two different briefings by very influential Jewish people from Israel, not Christians, basically just urging the churches and, in effect, America, please stay with us. Please support us. We need your support. Again, they're not coming from a Christian or prophetic point of view. They're just looking at being surrounded by nations who want their destruction. And they're saying, you're the only friends we have, United States, way on the other side of the ocean. Please stay with us. Please support us. Because they're worried that we're not as a nation. And you already hear a lot of people, what are we doing sending money over there? Let them support themselves and all that. And I fear for our nation. We are, as a nation, driving off an economic cliff. Now, I'm not a prophet or a son of a prophet. None of this has to do with prophecy. This has to do with basic math and economics, folks. We're driving off an economic cliff. And the Bush administration and the Republicans, when they controlled Congress, they were on a 10-speed bike going downhill without any brakes, going down this cliff. And President Obama and the Democrats that took over basically got off the bike, got in a Mustang, and hit the accelerator. Now, I don't know if that's the change that America thought they were voting for, but it is a change. I mean, it is a change. Went from a bike to a Mustang. But do you see in America the entitlement mindset that is developing? I need the government to help me out. I need those bare minimums. Just give me the crumbs. Keep me by. I'm afraid to step out of line. I'm afraid to do anything. I might get in trouble. We see that with so many people. Meantime, those who don't need the government's help, they're doing just fine, being lulled into sleep by just mindless entertainment and just distractions. And it's like the old Roman Empire all over again. Bread and circuses, right? Keep the common people, keep the masses, give them their bread, keep them filled, so they don't riot. And then the other people of influence, just keep them entertained so they don't have their mind on things that are really serious. While an entire middle class in our country is being destroyed, being taxed out of existence.